Welcome, everybody. This is The Holy Place, the Sacred Secrets of Southern France with myself, William Henry, and welcome. I want to offer to begin a special thank you to Robin Johnson of greatmystery.org. She has put all this together for us and did a beautiful job of bringing everyone together. Mike, her able assistant, done a wonderful job here as well. So really looking forward to today, and thank you all for being here and for sharing this experience with me. Today and tomorrow, Sunday, I'm going to take you to what I consider to be perhaps the, or one of the holiest places on earth, a place of almost ethereal and primitive, powerful beauty. It's rugged and wild country, this part of southern France that we're going to be visiting today. Our focal point, of course, is Rennes-le-Chateau, which features this iconic tower built by a mystery priest at the turn of the 20th century and has become the focal point, or the lightning rod, if you will, of some extraordinary conversations over the past 30 years or so. In our presentations, we're going to go deep into the lost secrets of Jesus and Mary Magdalene, as revealed by the Cathars of southern France who lived nearby to Rennes-le-Chateau. These teachings focused on, in my view, the perfection of the human body and our ascension. We're all on a spiral of ascension here, where we're morphing from our human phase into a more divine phase, a light body phase, a resurrected phase. This is all done in preparation, in my view, for entering the doorways or the portals to what the Bible, the book of Revelation, describes as the crystal halls of Christ's court, his heavenly location. After his resurrection and ascension, he went and dwelled with other transformed humans in a place called Sion, a celestial location that features these crystal halls. We're going to talk about what do we know about this place? How do we access it? And all of the who, what, where, when, why, and how of this incredible place. Christ's throne is the most holy place we can imagine, and we're going to be using our imagination in order to get there. Our presentation will be divided into three chapters. Today, we're going to be talking about the mystery portal of Rennes-le-Chateau. The next day is about the Templars, the Magdalene, and the Ascension Kit. And our third presentation is the Book of Love, the lost secret of the Cathars. By way of introduction, I first came upon this mystery in 1982, reading Holy Blood, Holy Grail. I picked up steam by being introduced to the work of Elizabeth Van Buren, once the Grande Dame of the Rennes-le-Chateau area, who introduced me to the concept of the Book of Love and many of these parallel mysteries that were first introduced to me in Holy Blood, Holy Grail. I started visiting the area in 1996, 17 years ago, and have been there many times since then. And I'm going back again in September. I'd like to invite you to join me if you're so inclined. So another slight preface before we get into the Rennes-le-Chateau story. I call this preface the morning of the resurrection, and he called her, or us, by name. This is, to me, the power pack that drives the entire Rennes-le-Chateau mystery. But without talking about this, we're really not exploring the mystery. So let's take us back to the book of John, chapter 20. It's Easter morning. Mary Magdalene stood weeping outside the tomb, inside her husband, her avatar, her Rabboni, her rabbi, her teacher. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels dressed in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. She turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she didn't know that it was Jesus. She took him for the gardener. They say she was crying and couldn't clearly see her husband. They say it was dark. She couldn't clearly see him. Woman, he said, why are you weeping? Who are you looking for? And supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you laid my husband, and I will take him away. And Jesus said to her, Mary, Mary, it's me, it's me. And then Mary Magdalene went and announced to the other disciples, I have seen the Lord, the risen Lord. And she told them that he had said these things to say to her. Now, That's our power pack. If that moment does not take place, we're not here today. Christianity's not here either, for that matter. But we are not talking about a mystery village of Rennes-le-Chateau in southern France, which is, as we're going to see, reputed to be one of the locations where the things that he told her, the things he told her in secret about his resurrection, about his attainment of the light body, where those things might in fact still be stored today. What did Mary Magdalene see that morning? What did she feel? What did she experience when she saw this mortal man whom she loved, whom she walked with, whom she fed, whom she bathed, who had now transfigured into another form? What could that be like to peer around the edge of that tomb? As she's doing here in this magnificent painting by Tissot, the tomb is guarded by a seraphim, one of the highest orders of angels, beings of pure light and pure love. And Mary is feeling angels, who are angels of the Lord, otherwise known as the Watchers, members of a holy race who came from a heavenly Sion, the Old Testament telling us they crossed a forbidden boundary and morphed into human form and took human wives. And based on biblical statements, we can safely say these sons of God, as the Watchers are also known, are divine or holy beings, say the Psalms. They're members of God's divine council in the celestial Sion, who have the ability to travel back and forth and to morph into human form, although they are not human. They are angels. They are not from earth. They are from the celestial Sion. They are from the throne of God, which is our goal. Our quest is to make it to that holiest of places. It's a non-human realm. It's a plane, a dimension, a domain. The other side, the spirit world, the afterlife that is populated by angels and just humans made perfect, humans who have completed the earthly cycle of human evolution and now dwell in this otherworldly realm. I seek to follow them, and I hope you do too. That's why you're here today, in my view. They are able to cross over into our world, these Watchers are. Humans can enter their world, the heavenly Sion, but first we must transform into angels or light beings. And in addition to the craft of human transformation into angels, the Watchers taught their offspring, the Nephilim, who are celestial plus human beings or hybrids, and humanity, forbidden knowledge of technology, including the art of building temple portals with massive stones. The remains of these Cyclopean structures are found in Israel, Egypt, Peru, Turkey, America, right in my backyard here in Nashville, in fact, very close to here. The remains of their secrets of angelomorphism, or transformation of a human into an angel, angelization, raising to the state of an angel, apotheosis, or deification, the transformation of a human into a divine being, and ascension, returning to heaven without dying, are their secrets. And they are found in the texts sprinkled throughout the world. And I've gone about trying to reassemble as many of those texts as possible. One text, a key text, in fact, that relates directly to our mystery today is the book of Numbers, chapter 13. Numbers 13, 33 in particular, speaks of Moses and the 12 tribes of Israelites are headed for the promised land. They're headed for Sion, the name of the Israelite and Jewish promised land. Moses sends two spies out to survey on a recon mission, survey this promised land looking for Sion. Joshua and Caleb are their names. Joshua, the mighty warrior of the Israelite nation, the hand-picked successor of Moses, and Caleb go to a place called Eshcol, which means the valley of the cluster, as in grapes. And they see the giants, the Nephilim, the sons of the Watchers, the offspring of the Watchers and the daughters of men, dwell at Eshcol, this valley of the cluster as in grapes. They steal, Joshua and Caleb do, this oversized cluster of grapes and pomegranates from the sons of Anak, also called the Anunnaki. And they come back to Moses and they report to him, Moses, we can't go anywhere near Eshcol in the promised land because the sons of Anak dwell there and their city is heavily fortified and they're well armed and they're mighty men, they're giants. They give to Moses this oversized cluster of grapes of proof of what they saw there. In addition to these giants, they said that the land there eateth the people up. Now, when you go to your Bible commentators, it says that what that means is that there was no food there, which is belied by the fact that this is the promised land. This is the land of milk and honey. How could the land consume them by not providing enough food? Or perhaps there was a drought, say Bible commentators. In my view, knowing that the watchers taught the sons of Anak and the Anunnaki the art and craft of morphing into light beings and traveling the cosmos as interdimensional beings through stargates and wormholes, I proposed in my book Blue Apples in 1998 that what Joshua and Caleb saw there were people walking along the surface of the earth and they suddenly vanished because they entered a portal or a gateway. The cluster of grapes, the oversized cluster of grapes that they stole and brought back to Moses represents, in my view, a key symbol of the secret of accessing those portals and likely, in my view, of how we transform ourselves into angelic beings. I'm going to ask you to consider that this valley of the cluster, as in grapes, this ruggedly beautiful, majestic setting portrayed in Poussin's painting we've been exploring here, is actually the vineyards and the rugged and majestic countryside of Rennes-le-Chateau and vicinity, with Petch Cardu and Mount Bougarach as the focal points. I believe the vineyards of the Anunnaki, the location of the portal to the celestial Sion, is in this area. And by following me, I will show you what I know about how we access this portal. So what happened to those two thieves and that cluster of grapes? I mean, the book of Numbers just drops it. I mean, you would think that the Bible would go on and on about how, oh yeah, Joshua and Caleb, they got the secret of the accessing portals from the Anunnaki, and here they are, this oversized cluster of grapes. And yeah, we're going to make a big deal out of this because this represents we now have the power of the angels. We now have the power of the gods themselves. But no, Numbers drops it cold. Our trail picks up, though, at a place called Sion or Sion in Switzerland, where in this amazing woodcut, we see Joshua and Caleb, the same two thieves, are now the same two thieves crucified on either side of Jesus. And they deliver the cluster of grapes of the Anunnaki, of the watchers, to the crucifixion. Now, this bas-relief from Sion illustrates a medieval belief in the concordance of the theft of the grapes, which I refer to as blue apples, from the Anunnaki and the crucifixion of Jesus. Old Testament scenes are grouped together in this mindset with the passion of Jesus as if they happened at the same time. That's kind of a mind stretch for some people to know that Bible scholars link these two events and say they happened at the same time. So what exactly was the function of this oversized cluster of grapes in the crucifixion of Jesus? Why did he need this energy, this symbolism, this connection to the watchers? Well, the reason is, and here we're looking at a photo of me at Sion pointing out that this intricate and gorgeous woodcut that features this concordance of these events. The fact is, though, that both Poussin's painting and this image that we see in Sion, Switzerland, are probably rooted in the same source, which is this woodcut here from Hieronymus Wyrix from 1607. In this detail, it shows, in the detail, we see the crucifixion with our same two thieves, but now we see a portal open behind Jesus. We see, in fact, a portal of light has opened behind Jesus. And in my view, this is not proof. We can't say it's absolute proof, but we can say that this is another example of an artist who shares my belief that the crucifixion was, in fact, a gateway event, where Jesus is demonstrating his understanding of the sacred knowledge brought to earth by the watchers and given to humanity at great personal cost to them. And that, in fact, we may say, as I concluded, the crucifixion was, in fact, a Stargate event. It was an event in which Jesus is demonstrating his ability to morph the human body into its next level of manifestation, call it an angel, a celestial being, a light being, an angel of the Lord, a holy being, whatever term you would like to use. And that cluster of grapes symbolizes the software. It symbolizes the consciousness that is required in order to open this gateway. This is a chalice which shows a representation of Christ as the vine. It's the grail. But the grail, the Holy Grail, is not a cup. The Holy Grail is a teaching. It's an understanding about who we are, where we came from, and the potential that is latent within all of us to transform, transfigure, or morph into light beings. The subject matter, the images I've just shared with you, are featured in my book, The Secret of Sion, which you can get from my website, williamhenry.net. It's full color, and it's important to me to say that what I'm intent on showing in The Secret of Sion as well as today is that the original religion of Jesus and Mary Magdalene, the secrets of Jesus and Mary Magdalene, are all about how we morph into our light body form. And so what I've attempted to do is to share the artwork that reflects this belief and gives you a visual cue, a way in to enter into this mystery. So here we are. This is William Blake's rendition of Mary in the tomb. We see the two watchers, the two angels in white, the holy ones beside her. They're like pillars beside her. She has her jar in front of her holding the precious oil, which we're going to talk about in detail momentarily. She looks up at the resurrected Christ, the Messiah, the avatar of her age, who is also her husband, perhaps even the father of her children. And he has gone through the complete cycle of earthly evolution and has now morphed into his light being form. He is resurrected, is the term. He is revealed as the Messiah is required to do, the secret of redemption, the secret of freeing souls. These are not religious concepts. These are not Christian concepts. We are using terminology that appears in Christian works, but the story I am telling you is not traditional Christianity. It's esoteric Christianity. It's called primitive Christianity. It's the original pure religion of Jesus and Mary Magdalene rather than the descriptive religion about them. I heard a scholar, a well-known scholar who was being interviewed about his book. He's a Muslim scholar. He teaches at a university in California, several PhDs. He described these people as illiterate peasants. That has got to be the farthest thing from the truth that I can imagine ever saying about Jesus and Mary Magdalene or the disciples. Illiterate peasants? These are some of the most highly trained esoteric initiates the planet has ever seen. They scoured the ancient world, ancient Iran, ancient Iraq, ancient Egypt, ancient India, in search of specific knowledge. How do we morph into our light being phase? And Mary Magdalene was the first to experience that light. Now, when I see a painting like this of the Magdalene reaching up to the light, I want to engage. I want to be there, so I do what she's doing. If Jesus is extending his arms to me, I mirror what he is doing. And in that way, I am engaging this artwork. That is part of the point of this. We don't just want to look at this artwork. We want to recognize that at one level, we are Mary Magdalene in the tomb, beholding the light of heaven, beholding and interacting with and engaging and receiving this transmission of the highest possible divine light imaginable to humankind. We are these figures that we see in these paintings. And so we engage by mirroring their body language, by mirroring what they are doing, by opening our hearts as Mary's heart is open at this moment, bringing this light in, allowing it to ignite our own consciousness, radiating this divine light from deep within ourselves, becoming this light, so that now we can share it with the world. I'm going to talk a lot more in detail tomorrow about how the Magdalene assembled this ascension kit, these secretive teachings about how we morph into the angels. And today, we're just acknowledging and getting into the story. Tomorrow, much more detail. As a result of this experience, Mary Magdalene was considered to be an ascended one herself. She was raised to the level of the Christ. And on Sunday, I will be sharing with you more about the ascension of Mary Magdalene herself and how she was viewed and portrayed as an ascended being. More to come on that. Very exciting aspect of the story of the Magdalene. So how do we begin to ignite our consciousness? How do we put on this Christ consciousness that we all hear about? What do we need to know? What do we need to do? What do we need to understand in order to more fully activate our latent potential, our latent capability? Well, that's why we've come together, is to share what we know about this and to contemplate, meditate, reflect on this potential that we all have within us. Latent within our divine spark is this magnificent light being. It's waiting to come out. It's in our DNA, just as sure as the acorn has the DNA of the magnificent oak tree. We have locked within our DNA the potential for each of us to become a magnificent, resurrected being of light, to put on this glory body, to glow rays, which after all is what the word glory means, to glow rays, to put on the light body, the garment of glory, the resurrection body. These are just a few of the terms that you see and read about in the Gospels for what Christ put on and what he sought to share with us during his short but powerful earthly mission. We all want to manifest this light being within us. And the message here is that we already are that being. We just simply need to begin to awaken this aspect of ourselves. So what I've gone about doing, as I said a moment ago, in the Secret of Sion and elsewhere, is to collect images, not of the bloody, tortured, suffering Jesus, because for sure that was an aspect of the story, but why? Why go through that? And the reason is because Jesus in his earthly mission is demonstrating for us how we morph into light. That's the whole point of Christianity, was for him to demonstrate this way that we all can become Christ-like beings. The problem is, though, you can't have a planet full of Christ-like beings running around, according to the church authorities, because they're unmanageable and they don't pay taxes. So, therefore, we're taught that, in fact, we can't do that. And we're sort of like the caterpillars looking at the butterfly, where Christ is the butterfly, saying, "You'll never get me up in one of those things." And it's because that's what our culture and the church wants us to believe. They want us to believe that we can't possibly imitate Christ. In so doing, we become what is called a heretic. And as you all know, or many of you know, there were millions of people throughout time who have been exterminated, murdered, eliminated because of their quest to become not just like Christ, but as Christ-like beings. So in my path, collecting this artwork, it has shown me a great deal about the interconnectedness of the Christian story with other traditions. This magnificent painting, Crucifixion, is by John Van Eyck, magnificent rendition of Christ manifesting the light body. Van Eyck, who we'll talk about again on Sunday when we explore his painting, The Mystic Lamb, perhaps more than many other painters of his time had insight into the alchemical transformation that the crucifixion represented, where Christ, who is here flanked by John the Baptist and Mary, is demonstrating his transformation, his transfiguration into a rainbow-like being. What I have noticed is that the way Christ is portrayed as a rainbow being is matched by the Tibetan tradition, which they refer to as the Great Perfection. In the Tibetan tradition, they teach that the human body is designed to be morphed into, or spun rather, I should say, into a multicolored, other dimensional light being status that they refer to as the rainbow body. Hair, toe, and fingernails are all that's left after the rest of our mortal coil is spun into this vortex of energy, again, manifesting as five-colored rainbow light, which in Tibet they refer to as the rainbow body or the great perfection. And what I believe is that in manifesting his rainbow or glow ray body, glorious body, Christ is shown manifesting, in fact, his rainbow body. After all, what was Jesus learning during those 18 missing years between 12 and 30? When they say he was in Mongolia and then Tibet, they say he was in Tibet. What was he learning? In my view, he was learning the art, the craft of the Watchers, the craft of morphing the human body into its next level of manifestation called the rainbow body and transfiguring into light, and then being able to phase back and forth just as the Watchers do, phase between flesh and light. I was in the George Washington Freemasonic Memorial in Washington, D.C. in the Knights Templar Chapel, where I took this photo of Christ manifesting the rainbow body or light body. He looks like Rocky to me. This isn't a suffering scene. He's experiencing victory. He's experiencing the ultimate light body manifestation, something that is wired into all of our DNA. He is becoming the Christ being. He is manifesting the rainbow body of light. He is a being of light. And this was, in my view, the original teaching of Christianity. This is what the church has removed and has sought to defend throughout the centuries. Now, when you take a look around, you start to see Christ on a rainbow at the crucifixion, here with the Mother Mary and the Magdalene. Magdalene identified by her intercrossed hands. We see Christ on the rainbow bridge, because that is the function of the rainbow body, is it acts as a bridge between the earthly realms and the heavenly realms. It is the portal through which we travel from the earthly realm into the heavenly realms. And this is the teaching Christ sought to bring to us. In this example here by Luca Signorelli, we see Magdalene, the initiator, the one with the backstory, the one with the knowledge, the understanding of how to make this work. I'm going to talk about the key role of that anointing oil in the manifestation of the rainbow body here in a moment. But look at what Signorelli very cleverly does here. When Christ was crucified, he shows him with a multicolored, and here's the detail of the Magdalene, but coming into a Christ on the cross, we see that he shows him with a multicolored garment wrapped around his waist. This is the garment of light, the rainbow garment, the coat of many colors of the Old Testament. It's symbolic, in my view, of the glory body, the rainbow body, the resurrection body, and it shows us that this is, we're following the path here of his generation or achievement of the rainbow body of light. Now, in my other presentations, The Path of Souls and elsewhere, I can take you to Egypt. And we will be doing that in a future presentation here with greatmystery.org, where we go to Stargate Egypt and I show you the incredible correspondence between the resurrection of Osiris and the resurrection of Christ and the resurrection of the Tibetan lamas who achieve the rainbow body. It's a teaching that appears in virtually all of the world's spiritual traditions, And it's all centered on how we access the portals or gateways into the divine realm. This is why, in his resurrected form, after the resurrection and ascension, Christ is shown enthroned. And when he's enthroned, he's sitting on a rainbow. This is why, in my view. It is because he has achieved the rainbow throne, the throne of the rainbow body. The rainbow body, by the way, according to the Tibetans, is taught in 13 star systems, including our own. And once we achieve the rainbow body that Tibetans teach, we're able to travel to these other star systems. My theory, and this is just William Henry's theory, because the Christians don't teach this, Jews don't teach that in their mysticism, the Tibetans don't teach it in their great perfection. This is my piecing together, if you will, of this mystery, that once we attain the rainbow body, and we can travel to these other star systems, as the Tibetans teach, we do so through wormholes and stargates, portals opened by our rainbow body. That's part of its capabilities. The vine that we see here surrounded by Christ as he's surrounded by 12 disciples symbolizes at one level the bloodline of Christ. At another level, it's Christ with his disciples. But there are 12 of these disciples who are all linked in this tree of life by Christ, who's the 13th. Figure in this image. What if the vine and the cluster of grapes also symbolizes the snaking wormholes that link the dimensions and link these other star systems? What if the cluster of grapes that grows from this tree symbolizes the teaching about how we morph into light beings? That's my big what if. And I'm asking you to ask what if with me and follow this path. And add your own bits to this, because I'm not trying to come off like some know-it-all here. This is the path that I'm following, and I'm sharing it with you, hopefully in an open-hearted and open-minded way, because I want to follow this path. I want to find that portal to Sion. I want to find that way that enables us to morph and to transform not only ourselves, but this entire planet through this full understanding of this teaching, whether it be in Christianity, Tibetan, tradition, the Jewish tradition, Jewish mystic tradition, Egyptian, wherever. And it is wherever. It's everywhere, guys. So what if the 12 disciples and Christ manifest as those 13 star systems in unity? And what if Christ is representative of this federation of star systems where this resurrection or redemption teaching is taught? It's a powerful idea, isn't it? To think that Earth and soul is somehow connected to other regions of space-time, and that these religious teachings are in fact about linking us with our brothers and sisters, our cousins in the stars, and about us becoming celestial beings ourselves and traveling the stars as star beings. That's the premise we're operating from. And I believe that between the resurrection and the rainbow body, between the resurrection body of Christ and the rainbow body of Tibetan Buddhism, that's the core. That's where the answers that we seek are. And tangential to that is the Egyptian resurrection teachings, the South American teachings, the Native American teachings, and so forth. That's all part of my path of soul stuff. But I'm going to focus it here on what they knew in southern France and the very important pieces that they bring to this great mystery that we're all involved in. And we're not just involved, because what I'm asking you to do, as I'm trying to do, is to put ourselves in the mystery, not as a spectator, but as a participant in these mysteries. We're not on the sidelines anymore. We're in it. We're on the field. We are playing the game. And we are looking to achieve this very same victory achieved by the lamas and by other initiates throughout time, who have been able to fully manifest the full potential of humanity. So before we go on, let's just acknowledge here that when the Tibetans show the resurrected lamas having achieved the rainbow body, they portray them traveling the cosmos in rainbow rings, rings of cosmic sovereignty, as they're described. And this is why, in my opinion, why the resurrected Christ is also portrayed in the same rainbow ring. It's because he has manifested the full human potential. And that was the point of the whole crucifixion, resurrection, and ascension story, That is the secret that is possessed by Mary Magdalene and by Jesus. So let's talk for a moment about Jesus on the subject of perfection. We go to the book of Matthew, where Jesus says, "I tell you the truth, it's hard for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. It's hard for a rich man to go through the star gate that leads to the celestial Sion," he's saying. "Again, I tell you, it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God." Now, I know that at one level, what Jesus is talking about here is that in order for a camel to enter the gate to the Temple of Solomon, it's got to get on its knees and get rid of its cargo. I understand that, that's a very common and very, in fact, mundane level of this. But I also understand that what Jesus is telling us here is that in order for us to go through the eye of the needle, the mouth of the wormhole, the portal, we have to shed our earthly skin. We have to shed our earthly cargo. We have to let go of our bodies of flesh and morph them, shed light on them, and morph them into light bodies. And in this amazing painting by Salvador Dali, this is a photo I took in the National Gallery in Washington, D.C., we see Christ at the Last Supper, and he's in an interphasic realm here. You can see the rainbow energy around his body. To me, it's palpable. I hope you can feel it just kind of dripping all over your body right now. You feel this rainbow energy coming as he morphs. He's neither fully here nor fully there. He's in that interphasic realm. And in fact, look what Dali has done. Look at the boat there at Christ's chest. He's showing it as almost an interdimensional boat that he is going to ride upon. He's going to sail upon this ship of eternity into other dimensions. What had happened in this episode is that a rich man had asked Jesus, he said, "Jesus, what's required for eternal life?" And Jesus answered, "Follow the commandments." The commandments are love with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like unto it, love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments. How do we open the gate to heaven? How do we achieve the rainbow body of light? Love with all your heart, all your mind, and all your soul. It's that easy. But doing it is the hard part. And as they say, you always teach what you need to know most. And believe me, it's a day-to-day, moment-to-moment, every time I blink my eyes, an opportunity to decide how to fulfill these commandments. How much do I want to be a being of light and love? Every moment of our lives is judgment day, because one day, according to the Christian tradition and the Egyptian, our heart will be weighed against the feather of cosmic truth. And all the gods, all the divine beings, all the watchers want to know is, how filled of light and love are you? How lighthearted are you? That's it. That's what it's all about. So if there's one message you take from this, this is it right here. Well, the rich man didn't want to have any of that. He told Jesus, "Hey, dude, you know, I've always kept those commandments. And, you know, what else is required? I've got $24 here. Jesus, can you sell me the secret of eternal life?" Obviously, this rich man hadn't been following the commandments because he wouldn't have asked such a question. But here's our punchline. Here's our important moment. Here's what Jesus is trying to teach him. He says, if thou wilt be perfect, meaning whole, holy, and complete, go and sell what you got, give it to the poor, and then you'll have treasure in heaven, and come and follow me. What he's saying is, we got to ultimately let go of all this earthly stuff. That's the only way we're going to get through that gate to Sion. We have to become beings of light and love. And love is the only way to open that gate. So this is the secret. This is what Jesus and Mary Magdalene knew. this is what's going on in the tomb when the angel is sitting there on the sarcophagus, the Ark of the Covenant. Oh, excuse me, did I just say that's the Ark of the Covenant? I'm going to get back to that in the next presentation. Mary and the Marys are assembled around the tomb. Their brother has just manifested his light body, his resurrection body. Mary, one of the Marys, looks into the tomb. The Magdalene holds her jar that contains this sacred anointing oil. Jesus then says, come and follow me. Follow me through the portal. Follow me through the gate. And that's the whole thing that separates the biblical tradition about Jesus and the extra-biblical, the apocryphal or Gnostic tradition, is that the Gnostics were concerned with what Jesus taught them after the resurrection, about how to navigate the afterlife realms, how to travel to Sion. And he's demonstrating, he's like, I call Jesus in some instances, Mary Magdalene's daredevil test pilot. She's the one that has a lot of this knowledge, and she's like, well, let's try out this oil here. It's going to dissolve you into light. You're going to go through the gateway. You're going to go to Sion. You're going to come back. You're going to talk to me. I can't say that that was exactly their plan, but I think they had a conversation, something like that, before the crucifixion. It was all prearranged. They knew exactly what was going to be happening here. And he is fulfilling his promise to her and to their children that he would return, that he would continue on, that life would go on, and that his sacrifice would not be in vain. And Magdalene and her lineage have made sure of that. So to be called by name by the resurrected or risen Jesus, as was the Magdalene, was an astounding experience for her. The Gospel of Mary says he transmitted to her the secrets of awakening the light body and the secrets of navigating the afterlife. As Jesus told her, as he told the Magdalene, the Pistis Sophia, he said, cease not to seek day and night the purifying mysteries which will purify you and make you into a refined light so you will go on height and inherit the light of my kingdom. That's north. That's our North Star. If you're wandering around out here wondering what's really going on in your spiritual quest, in your spiritual life, your spiritual walk, and you're trying to improve, or you're trying to shift, change, whatever terminology you prefer to use, That's our mission statement. We should put that on our refrigerator door. We should put that on our mirror. Put it on our computer. Put it on our steering wheel of our car. This is our focus. Don't do anything day and night. Just find those purifying mysteries that will make you into a refined light equals the purified, perfected rainbow body of light so that you'll go on height and inherit the light of my kingdom. What more do we need to know? When Mary encounters the gardener, the Rabboni, her master, the avatar, the resurrected Jesus on Easter morning, he transmits those secrets to her. And in particular, like this photo here that I took at St. Maggiore in Rome, I look for the examples where he's transmitting these secrets directly into her consciousness, into her pineal gland, which we'll talk about later. Because this is, I believe, was a core part of their understanding. They knew the pineal gland was a manufacturing plant capable of manufacturing sacred oils, oils that contain the secrets or secretions that contain the secrets of transmuting the body into light. That's the oil in the jar. There's nothing in the jar. The Bible says it was, I can't even think what it was, of myrrh? Not frankincense, it was, it doesn't even matter, because it wasn't that. That's just a symbol. The oil is within us. It's produced within our consciousness. And anybody who's wanting you to look for an oil out here isn't asking you to really look in here, to do it yourself. This is a DIY manual. Do it yourself manual here, okay? And once we start to look at it that way, we, again, place ourselves into this scene here. I took this photo in the Church of Mary Magdalene, Fifehead Magdalene, in Dorset, England. It happened to be my wife's favorite church. She used to go there all the time, and it was a place of tremendous healing and sanctuary for her. Magdalene beholds the light of heaven. She brings it into her being, into her consciousness. Jesus wears the bright white garment of light. The bright white garment of light is the garment of these holy beings, because when you mix all the colors of the rainbow, you get white. And what it indicates is that these are fast-moving beings. They're a blur to our light. When they slow down, we can see their rainbow body. But when that rainbow body is really spinning and it's ultimate, it's pure white. It's like a blur. Can't even see it, hardly. It's that fast, that higher vibration. Christ had achieved that level. And in all these instances, here we are, Church of John the Baptist, or Joseph of Arimathea, rather, in Glastonbury, England, where I took this photo. Jesus appears to the Magdalene on Easter morning, transmits to her, look at it, transmitting, beaming these secrets, this light to his beloved. She now embodies it. It's in her DNA. It's in the DNA of her offspring. And maybe it even continues into the bloodline today. But the message here that he shares is that humanity came from a divine world, and that from time to time there are messengers who come from this kingdom of light in order to light the way of the path of souls, to remind souls of the knowledge of the light, and to guide them on the path of return to the light. I believe you are those messengers, and this is why we have gathered today, is to remember this, to remember what happened in that tomb, in that bright white garment of light, that linen garment seen here on that bench. That's the key to our mystery. In addition to the cluster of grapes, we want to follow and fully understand that garment of light. We know it today as the Shroud of Turin. And of course, this is the linen shroud that the body of Christ was wrapped in by various individuals, including likely the Magdalene. This image is a powerful reminder of this event. And it was thought that this linen shroud that contains these secrets, it's an actual relic or icon of Christ's manifestation of the rainbow body. There is a school of thought that says that it was taken for a time to this mysterious place, Mont Ségur in southwestern France, the Mount of Salvation, the last stronghold of the Cathars, the pure ones who believed that they possessed Christ's secrets of angelification. And they built this fortress. Here's the latest reconstruction of it. Immense wealth, immense resources went into the construction of this place. And I can't think of a more noble looking place to house this powerful relic of the crucifixion and resurrection and ascension and rainbow body than what we're looking at here with Mont Ségur. So when I go to Mont Ségur, it's in part with this in the back of my mind, but more it's with understanding that the Cathars possessed this secret of unsheathing the body, of uncoiling the mortal coil, of spinning the body into its next level of manifestation. And I believe that the shroud image was formed, as science is now verifying, by a short, intense burst of energy, of radiant energy that came from within the body of Jesus, the figure who's shown on the shroud. And it would seem that the dead body which the shroud wrapped rose, we are now told, by latest research into a vertical position when the image was formed. Momentarily, we are told, shining brighter than the sun. Imagine that. Your divine spark, I hope right now, is doing this. It's connecting. It's saying, yes, this is the path that I'm on. This is within me. I, too, can manifest my celestial body, light body, rainbow body, immortal body, glory body, whatever term you prefer to use for it. December 2011. Scientists announced that the Turin Shroud was created by a flash of supernatural light, their terms, and it couldn't be a medieval forgery, say these scientists. These scientists from Italy's National Agency for New Technologies, Energy, and Sustainable Economic Development spent years trying to replicate the Shroud's markings. They have concluded only something akin to ultraviolet lasers, far beyond the capability of medieval forgers, could have created them. And this has led to fresh suggestions that the imprint was indeed created by a huge burst of radiant energy accompanying the resurrection of Christ. The results, these scientists say, show A short and intense burst of UV directional radiation can color a linen cloth so as to produce many of the peculiar characteristics of the body image on the shroud. My wife Claire and I visited the shroud in 2010 when it was put on display for the first time in 10 years. It was an amazing experience. I saw a golden being of light manifest in my meditation in front of the shroud. I don't know who the being was, but all I know is it felt like a divine type of being that might even have been protecting the shroud. It didn't feel like it was Jesus that I was seeing, feeling, and experiencing. Rather, it felt like another being who was there to say, follow this. This is north. You're on the right track. Understand what this is. So on the left and right are photographs, one I took of the Shroud of Turin myself, and one of a photographic image of the shroud that was on display at one time at Saint Sulpice in Paris, France. I personally believe that the Shroud of Turin is evidence of Christ manifesting his resurrection body or his rainbow body, where he burst into light, momentarily shining brighter than the sun, as we see in Matthias Greenold's As Eisenheim altarpiece, and as William Blake shows in his image of the crucifixion. Think about it. If millions of people, as they do, began to meditate on the crucifixion of Christ, and instead of meditating on the suffering, instead manifested on him manifesting our light body, and that, in fact, we, too, are manifesting our light body. Imagine if instead of millions upon millions of images of a crucified Christ, we saw millions upon millions of images daily of Christ manifesting the light body. I think it could have an enormous impact on our culture. In 2012, scientists used infrared light and spectroscopy, the measurement of radiation intensity through wavelengths, to analyze the fibers from the shroud. The scientists have now dated the age of the shroud to between 300 BC and 400 AD, a date range that, of course, includes the periods in which Jesus lived. Science is telling us this is the real deal. Pope Francis came out in 2013, and in a carefully worded message, he asked and answered a rhetorical question. How is it that the faithful, like you, pause before this icon of a man scourged and crucified? It is because the man of the shroud invites us to contemplate Jesus of Nazareth. Icon is a very important choice of words for Pope Francis, who undoubtedly chose his words very carefully here. An icon in Christian terminology is very different from an idol. And part of the reason people don't study the shroud is because they believe they're told it's idol worship. In theology, as in computer speak, an icon is a sort of a portal, a mirror that can lead the user into a different reality. And by clicking on an icon on your computer screen, you're invited into this invisible realm where you can do applications or go to other portals or gateways. But people miss the point often of an icon, so the theory goes, if they focus too much on the object itself, picking apart its age, its construction, its history, so forth, and they forget simply to gaze upon it, to view it as a mirror, to recognize that we are all crucified. We are all resurrecting. We are all ascending. And by following the path laid for us and exemplified in this icon, we can more fully manifest our destiny. So looking upon the man of the shroud, I make St. Francis of Assisi's prayer before the crucifix my own, says Pope Francis. Francis's prayer says, Most high and glorious God, enlighten the darkness of my heart and grant me true faith, certain hope, and perfect charity. Those are Cathar terms, guys. I'm going to talk about Francis of Assisi in our third presentation. I'm going to talk about the meaning to the Cathars of the word charity. I will tell you now, it means light beyond light. Charity, meditating on perfect charity means being bathed within the most illuminating light imaginable. And that's what Christ manifested before Mary Magdalene, was that light. It's called perfect charity. Francis goes on saying in St. Francis's prayer, grant me true faith, certain hope, and perfect charity, sense and understanding, Lord, so that I may carry out your holy and true command. In other words, his command is to be a being of light and love. Love with all your heart, all your mind, all your soul, and love your neighbor as yourself. That is the command of Christ. Pope Francis doing an amazing job of telling us exactly what he thinks. That is, the Shroud of Turin is real. Although Jesus taught his ordinary disciples by scripture, parable, myth, and precept, Luke's gospel tells us that to his inner cycle of disciples, he transmitted, meaning beamed or gifted, spiritual power directly, and passed on his secrets so that they could carry on his work. This happened at the Last Supper, when Jesus gathers the disciples together and gave them power and authority. The power and authority he gave them is exactly the same power through which he resurrected or manifested the rainbow body of light. This is the power or authority he has shown here transmitting or gifting to Mary Magdalene at the Last Supper. It is the power and authority of manifesting the light body. And as I've said before, Magdalene was the primary recipient of this transmission. And it was through her line and her teaching that this power line continued throughout time. And we are seeking that power line by going to Rennes-le-Chateau, by studying these mysteries, by looking into esoteric Christianity. We're seeking to grab a hold of that lifeline, that power line, that line of light and love that was provided by the mission that these two figures, this husband and wife team, manifested for us. He gave them the power. He gave them the authority. And we now are asked to accept that power and that authority, to use it in our lives for the betterment of our own lives as well as all on this planet. The Greek word for this power, is exousia. It means authority, jurisdiction, liberty, power, right to act, ability, privilege, capacity, and strength. This is what Christ gave to the disciples, a sacred power or energy that is cosmic, supernatural, and superhuman. It is the great power, the hidden power, the divine power that descended at the baptism and gives us our shining shape according to the Gnostic Gospels. So as Jesus said, cease not to seek day and night, and remit not yourselves until you find these purifying mysteries, which will purify you and make you into a refined light so that you will go on light and inherit the light of my kingdom. So now, with that understanding, we're ready to go to the mountain. We know what we're seeking. We're asking for that power, that authority, to be given to us, to be activated within us. My journey to the mountain began in 1982 when I read this book, Holy Blood, Holy Grail, by Misters Michael Bagent, Richard Lee, and Henry Lincoln. I want to acknowledge the recent passing of Mr. Bagent, who was the brains behind Holy Blood, Holy Grail, a kind and, in my view, elegant, gracious, just absolute sophisticated gentleman who was a scholar who really wanted to get a handle on what were the original Christian mysteries. And I tip my hat to Mr. Bagent, who is the one who led us to Rennes-le-Chateau as the location or ground zero, if you will, where we might find the secrets of Jesus and Mary Magdalene. In Holy Blood, Holy Grail, the authors tell us that Jesus and Mary Magdalene were married, that their secrets were preserved in this mystery village that's named after the chateau, the alchemical tower you're seeing in this photo. And by following the trail to Rennes-le-Chateau, they take us to the story of a mystery priest by the name of Berenger Saunier. Now, I have to just say here that in May of 2013, I took a group to Rennes-le-Chateau in hopes of hearing in detail from Mr. Lincoln about the mysteries of Rennes-le-Chateau. There were 22 of us who were gathered for a lunchtime presentation by Mr. Lincoln. And sadly, or much to my surprise, he told us that everything that he said in Holy Blood, Holy Grail, in fact, the whole book is rubbish. Not to believe a single word he says, not to believe a single word in the book. He refused to sign the book unless the right color pen was produced. I had a senior woman, a woman who's a senior citizen on the tour, who brought her copy of the book to him and hiked it up the mountain at Rennes-le-Chateau to see him and to talk with him about it. And she offered him a blue pen, then a black pen, then a red pen, purple pen. It wasn't until we found a brown pen that Mr. Lincoln would draw an X through his name and say, this book is rubbish. Now, what does that leave us with? Well, it leaves us with an understanding that perhaps he has discovered something that refutes what Holy Blood, the premise of Holy Blood, Holy Grail. But in my estimation, there is enough other evidence out there apart from Holy Blood, Holy Grail that would lead us to believe that there's something of immense significance, perhaps concealed or hidden or awaiting discovery in the vicinity or through the study of following Jesus and Mary Magdalene's trail to Rennes-le-Chateau. So with that said, we push forward. The short version of the Rennes mystery has it that one day in 1891, this priest, Baron J. Saunier, is making repairs on the badly decaying church of Mary Magdalene there at the hilltop of Rennes-le-Chateau. He's dirt poor, and as the story goes, which is now legendary, he accidentally discovered a cache of ancient parchments that were concealed in wooden tubes in this pillar that he's standing beside outside the church of Mary Magdalene. With this knowledge, with this discovery, he apparently becomes suddenly immensely wealthy, and he commences building projects and other strange behavior on the hilltop around Rennes-le-Chateau, including the building of the Villa Britannia, this magnificent residence where he lavishly entertained high profiles and sometimes elite guests, in which now is, again, the ground zero for the Rennes-le-Chateau mystery. The Villa Britannia is a place I've stayed in on occasion. It's very, very kind of spooky place, to be perfectly honest with you. It's devoted to, of course, the Magdalene, like everything on this hilltop. This is Saunier on the day of the dedication of the newly refurbished Church of Mary Magdalene. As most know, he invested a fortune in refurbishing this tiny church. This is me on my first visit there in 1996, standing at the door, immense door of this immense mystery, kind of green, eyes wide open, looking for something and following the trail. And here I am now in the spring of 2013, still on the trail. It's because there's a power pack here at Rennes-le-Chateau. There's something of immense power that draws us in, that draws us there. We know that we are close to or on the edges of something of immense significance in our lives. We maybe feel a past life connection there. Maybe we're just wanting to go there to experience the majestic beauty, the wild beauty of this place. But for me, and I think tens of thousands, maybe hundreds of thousands more, maybe even millions, this is a place that offers refuge. It offers sanctuary. It offers connection to other like-minded and like-hearted people. And for some, it represents power. If we can crack the mysteries of this alchemical tower constructed by Saunier and thought to be modeled after another one in Girona, Spain, then we're going to gain some kind of power, some kind of authority, maybe even. We, meaning you and I, don't seek these secrets for the love of power, as do many. We seek them for the power of love. We seek them because we believe that encoded within this magnificent structure and everything else that Saunier left us here is, you know, one of Reese's pieces. We're like E.T. following those Reese's pieces, and we're wanting, like E.T., to return home. So I don't dwell exclusively on Rennes-le-Chateau, something I have learned very early on is that the mystery of Béranger Saunier and the Church of Mary Magdalene there is just maybe the icing on the cake. This whole area, the red-eye Languedoc region, is a layer cake going back. How far back do you want to go, I should say? 200 years? 2,000 years? 20,000 years? 200,000 years? We can talk about it on all of those levels, and there are aspects of it that are crucial for us to understand on all those levels. My point is that when we're walking this land, you're going to experience something. You are going to connect. The secrets that we seek are in the air. I believe following the Tibetan Terma tradition, that the secrets we seek are downloaded into the rocks, into the geology, into the air, into the trees, into the every glass of wine, into the water you drink, which, by the way, is some of the purest water I've ever had the pleasure of drinking in my life, coming right out of the earth. And just beneath the surface, underground here, is where it's all happening. Like Egypt, what you see on the surface in the vicinity of Rennes-le-Chateau, just markers. They're just covering everything else. It's underground. Remember, at Eshkol, the Valley of the Cluster, as in Graves, people accessed portals. They went underground at this location. And trust me, when you start looking around Rennes-le-Chateau, you start seeing all the caves and cave entrances and all the other connections to the inner earth and the inner realms. It's pretty literal. We're looking for an entranceway underground. So let's look at the Tour Magdala. Wonderful structure. I used to live on the edge of a cliff overlooking the lake, and it used to be my heart's desire 20 years ago to duplicate this on the cliffside where I lived here in Nashville. I've since moved from that place, and you know, who knows, maybe one day I will recreate Magdala as Saunier did, the Tour Magdala, the Tower of Alchemy. Sunday we're going to talk about Mary Magdalene and the Merkaba mysteries, because that's what we understand was the business of Magdala. The word means the tower, but it's also a reference to the ladder or tower or stairway to heaven. Mary Magdala or Mary of Magdala means Mary of or who knows the secrets of the ladder, tower, or stairway to heaven. That's what we're looking for. Saunier knew that, I believe. And by following his trail here to the Tour Magdala, or E.T. again, picking up the Reese's pieces, and we're bringing it into our being, and we're moving on. We're continuing and understanding what he was doing. I love what Saunier did. All this wealth. He creates this library, which is what the Tour Magdala was, an orangery, this magnificent belvedere. I've had wonderful experiences here, and seek to share those experiences with you too. Here's the tile work on the floor of his library. Very portal-like, really love it. Nice little meditation mandala in a way. Nice centering tool, really like it. Keep it on my desktop from time to time. Like to study it, just bring it up and tune in to Saunier as best I can. He walked this floor. Maybe we can walk it with him by just thinking, what was he thinking as he's looking at this mandala on the floor? The Trinity symbol here, the gateway symbol that leads into the sacred realms. Cleverly marked here by Saunier. If you wanted to visit Rennes-le-Chateau, and pardon me for this crass commercial message, but we will be taking another Doorways into Other Dimensions tour to Rennes-le-Chateau, exploring these mysteries firsthand, September 25th through October 4th. I have just a couple of places left and would love to have you join us. But thank you for once again for being here today, for sharing this work and for supporting it and for assisting us in bringing this knowledge forward. I want to sit in Saunier's seat. My wife Claire took this photo. This is the very same chair, by the way, we saw just a moment ago Saunier standing by out front of the Church of Mary Magdalene. Just sit there for a moment in your imagination. Think about Saunier. Think about all his visitors, the conversations they must have had. They've discovered something of immense significance, and now Saunier is a wanted man, in a way, wanted by church and other elite authorities for what he knows. He's probably going to be used by them. He might even be fearing for his life. He might just be a simple con man. who conned some very wealthy people a lot of money. You know, a lot of people have different perspectives. And this is why in my quest, I tend to just kind of, you know, check in with the priest Baron J. Saunier, but I don't dwell on him. But it's still, I think he knew something of immense significance. He created one of my favorite images of the resurrection, Christ bursting into the sunlight in his Calvary image, the Calvary image that's just outside the Church of Mary Magdalene. Love that image. The whole sunburst idea is just beautifully portrayed for us. Love to see it painted, actually. It's kind of rusting out right now, but just imagine if it was, you know, really bursting into light. Inri, by the way, really important in the esoteric tradition. Elizabeth Van Buren, again, who first hit me off about the esoteric side of Rennes-le-Chateau, locked on to the Book of Love in 1996 when I read her book, Refuge of the Apocalypse. She was one of the first who noted for me that Inri actually doesn't stand for Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews. Instead, it means by fire, frequency, or vibration, humanity is renewed, made whole, or complete. So there it is. That's the point. It's all about us becoming a vessel, a grail, that's capable of holding this inri frequency or vibration that transmutes the body into light. Did Saunier know that? I don't have it in writing. Don't have an email from him, text message, or a message in a bottle even from him that says that that's what he knew. But I do enjoy following the signs that he left behind that suggest that that's a possibility. Here we are looking at the Church of Mary Magdalene, the famous tiny church that was refurbished by Saunier, thought to sit on a pad of a far more ancient structure, perhaps even a temple of Isis. Interesting to contemplate that. This is the entranceway into the Church of Mary Magdalene. And upon entry, standing outside, we are greeted by the doorway. Up above, we will see Mary Magdalene. And she's standing in a portal or a gateway, surrounded with two flower pots on either side, flanked by yet another two. You can see that she's on a sort of a Saqqara-like stairway to heaven image, a ziggurat, if you will. She's on top of the mountain. The mountain that she stands atop is called Sion, or Sion is another popular way of pronouncing Sion. It's spelled S-I-O-N. The technical pronunciation is Sion. Sion, man, Sion. Sion into the greater realm. Sion, or Sion, if you will. And so here's the Magdalene. Now, some, when they look at this, look at the folds of her skirt here. Some see a serpent snaking its way up the folds of her dress. It's kind of interesting to me. She is, you could stretch your imagination and say, gosh, the way her dress flanges almost looks like she's pregnant. When you look at what she's holding, some people say that she's holding a cross. Other people say, yes, it's a cross, and she's cradling it like a sword. I look at that and say, looks to me like she's cradling it more like a child, like an infant. I don't see her holding a delicate sword. I see her holding a child as if she's feeling blessed to be holding this divine child. So we all have to kind of make up our minds about what we want to see here, what we want to see on, if you'll allow me to express the pun. Fact is, though, that the real clue, in my opinion, in this doorway is this inscription here. Terrible is this place. Terrible is this place, has Saunier inscribed above the entrance to the Church of Mary Magdalene. This is exactly what Jacob expressed on that morning at Luz. In the book of Genesis, he lays his head on a stone, falls into a dream, sees a ladder ascending into the heavens, actually snaking into the heavens. He scales that ladder. Note the pun again. He's scaling the serpentine ladder. It's also, the pun is also important because he's scaling himself up to a higher vibration. He is seeing angels ascending and descending on either side. Jacob, as he scales this ladder, not only sees these beings dressed in white, because they are celestial beings, light beings after all. But he gets up to the top and he sees El, Yahweh, standing there. He comes back down the ladder. He wakes up and he says, terrible, meaning awesome, powerful is this place. This is none other than the gate to God, and this is heaven. This is the gate to heaven. Does Sonia want us to believe that this is the awesomely powerful place that is the gate to Sion? He does to me. That's the way I read this anyway. This is Eshkol. This is the valley of the cluster of, as in grapes. This is the portal. This is the awesome place of power where we get the power of love, to scale that ladder, just like Jacob did, just like Jesus did. And as I said a moment ago, this is the business of the folks from Magdala. They are knowledgeable in the secrets of resurrection. I'm going to talk about that in more detail on Sunday. Mary of the Tower, Mary of the Ladder to Heaven. Sonia is telling us this. And souls, by the way, who ascend the pillar of light wear the pure garment of light or robe of glory, the rainbow body. This celestial or light body is given to us by the messenger, another name for Christ, which is thought of, this garment is a conveyor of the soul to the realm of light. That's what I said a moment ago about the wormhole that is opened by our rainbow body. And I propose, as have others said before, that Sonia, by putting this expression over the church, is telling us, pay attention to this place as a repository of the secrets of this gateway. Which is no surprise, then, that we're greeted by Asmodeus, who is the guardian of the secrets of that great ancient stargate, well known to Jesus and Mary Magdalene, called the Temple of Solomon, which functioned, as I will demonstrate to you tomorrow in our presentation, where Jesus, as the high priest of the order of Melchizedek, utilized the tools of the temple and opened the portal or gateway, went beyond the veil of the Holy of Holies of Solomon's temple, and entered heaven alive and came back. It'll be mind-blowing for some to follow this path. This is the trail I followed in my book, The Judgment Day Device. And I'm very excited to present it to you, and I think you'll really enjoy what I've discovered about how Jesus and Mary Magdalene actually utilized Solomon's Stargate. So no surprise that Sonia would feature Asmodeus as the guardian of the gateway to Sion. Sonia used this figure in his book plate. This is a reproduction of it here. See at the bottom where the BS doesn't stand for what we're told Holy Blood, Holy Grail is, BS. But actually it stands for Berenger Sonia. And we are now then led into following an examination of the symbolism that this same device that Sonia used on his book plate appeared on the frontispiece to Heinrich Medathinus's Aureum Seclum Redivium, The Golden Age Revived, which was first published in Frankfurt, Germany, 1625. Medathinus was the pseudonym of Adrian von Mieschicht, an alchemist, esotericist, and apologist for the Rosicrucian impulse, as we are told. So did Sonia lift this out of an alchemical treatise that we received, maybe even this one here by Medathinus? Can't say for sure. Again, no text, email, or message in a wine bottle, but following the Rhesus pieces, we're asked to at least factor this in as a possibility. By the way, Sonia's book plate, the same curious symbol, is also prominently displayed in an enigmatic monument in Rome, Italy, known as the Porta Alchemica, or Alchemical Door. This door, which is covered in hermetic and alchemical symbols and quotations, is to be found on the walls of the Villa Palombara, located in the Piazza Vittorio Emanuele. I haven't been there personally, don't have a photograph of myself, haven't seen it with my own eyes, so I can't tell you for certain that this place actually exists, although I presume that it does. But let's just kind of put a little sticker here and say, okay, we're open to suggestion on this one. First thing after we see Asmodeus when we enter the church is this statue here of John the Baptist baptizing Jesus in a cornfield. In a cornfield? I thought corn's a New World plant. Yeah, that's the dialogue that goes on around this image. Why is John the Baptist baptizing Christ in a cornfield? So here's Jesus in a prayer position while John is baptizing him with a, not with the dove of the Holy Spirit, but with a silvery cockle shell. A silvery cockle shell. Ecce Agnus Dei. Behold, the Lamb of God is the inscription on the serpentine-like ribbon or banner on John's staff. What is Sonia, who is responsible for this imagery, trying to convey to us? Is he asking us to lock on the silvery cockle shell? As we click on this, we recognize that the baptism was all about the descent of the power. This is where Jesus got it. It was transmitted to him by John the Baptist. It's symbolized by the dove of the Holy Spirit. And in this painting by Wanda Flandes, which I took in the National Gallery in Washington, D.C., we see John transmitting this higher vibrational rainbow-like energy into the open crown chakra of Christ. Now, this is obviously an attunement of some kind that John is doing on Jesus. But also, I want you to just take a moment in your imagination to open your own crown chakra. And let's go back through the images and see if you can place yourself in this image. See if you can connect with and feel this divine light, this light of perfect charity, perfect light and love, descending from the cosmic realms and dripping viscerally, palpably into, from this celestial dove, into your open crown chakra. Just feel this light washing over your face, down your neck and your shoulders, your arms, your elbows, your hands, your chest, your stomach and abdomen, your hips, your thighs, all the way down to the soles of your feet, so that now your entire body is enclosed within a rainbow-like garment of light that is cleansing, that is purifying, that is empowering, that is in fact protecting you and preparing us for the next stage in our journey today. Now, in the next stage of Jesus' journey, he is given his garment of light as a result of the baptism by John, as a result of his receipt of this transmission of light and love. It's after this that Jesus begins performing his miracles. The first miracle, of course, is the transfiguration. We'll get to that in a moment. But one of my favorite Orthodox, not really Orthodox, but establishment Christian stories involves St. Augustine, who's portrayed here in this painting of Augustine with the seashell. It's a poor reproduction. I apologize for it. I'm really trying to find a high-res version of it because what is telling us this story, Augustine is walking along a beach and he's contemplating the mysteries of the Trinity. When he sees a young child, as shown here in the painting, a young boy who's got a pail in his hand and he's walking out to the ocean, out to the sea, and he's walking back and he's got a hole in the shore. And he's pouring water into this hole he's dug on the shore. And Augustine is watching him go back and forth, getting a pail, pouring it into the hole. And he walks up and he says, young man, what are you doing? And he says, well, I'm going to take the entire contents of the ocean and I'm going to pour it into that hole. And Augustine says, well, young man, that's impossible. The young man says, no, what's impossible is that with that pea-sized brain of yours, you'd ever be able to fully understand the mysteries of the Trinity. And with that, the young man turned into an angel and walked on water. I kind of feel like I've been following that angel for a while, at least since the early 80s when I got into researching the Rennes-le-Chateau mysteries and following this, because I believe those watchers are there. I believe they are looking for us. They're watching and waiting for us to develop our own consciousness. They're waiting to interview us so that then they can help us to complete our ascension. Those watchers are also known as the seraphim angels. I'll talk about that more later as well. But for now, I just want you to note that the logo of the seraphim is the serpent on a pole. That's exactly what John is shown portrayed here by Sonia, as he's He's holding the image of the seraphim, these highest order of angels here, as he's transmitting the silvery, the light of the divine light symbolized by the silvery cockle shell here. So Sanye, he likes to play. He likes to play with his symbols. He likes to think that you're going to click on these icons and follow them into the invisible world. And he's not, you know, there to tell us what it is. He's not going to preach, but he is going to offer us a handle, a way to grab a hold of these mysteries. I love this image here, just in passing, of John the Baptist holding the mystic lamb. We're going to talk about the mystic lamb on Sunday and the meaning of it, its relationship to the golden fleece, the light body garment. But I love anytime John's holding a serpent, because he's got the power line right by the tail. He's got the power line that we're following up to this mountain at Rennes-le-Chateau in search of. He's got a hold of it, and he transmitted it to Jesus. And Magdalene, of course. Inside the Church of Mary Magdalene, we have this wonderful statue of the Magdalene holding a cross. And for a while, I thought it was green. That excited me because I thought it suggested it's a living tree. I think that message, though, is going to become loud and clear, that Sanye believed that the cross was a living tree rather than the dead wood and the dead guy of traditional Catholic teaching. Instead, we're looking for living wood in a living being. So here's the Magdalene. She's got the tree, the skull, and her jar that symbolizes that anointing oil. And wow, really fascinating and powerful to connect with the first time you go into this church, to actually see this for yourself. When you see it in books, it's one thing, but when you're actually in the church, it can be pretty overwhelming. So I'm actually not going to show you all of the church. We could spend years arguing, dissecting, changing our mind about what we see in this church, but instead we're trying to hit the highlights to get to the message that I think was the ultimate, what we're ultimately to take from it. Favorite piece of stained glass in the church is, of course, Christ raising Lazarus from the dead, assisted by the Magdalene. The Mount of the Beatitudes is on the wall opposite to the altar. We see a bag of gold at the base of the mountain. Lots of mysteries about this. They try to identify this geographical location as actually being a mountainside in the vicinity of Rennes-le-Chateau. I suppose it's a possibility. I don't focus that intently on it because I'm more interested in the altar. This seems to be the place that Sanye most wanted to direct our attention, the altar of the Church of Mary Magdalene, which he's responsible for creating, by the way. He was refurbishing this altar when he discovered the wooden parchment, or the tubes containing the parchments. He used his wealth to create this altar, and I believe there's a message here. In fact, he painted the painting of Mary Magdalene at the base of the altar. It's tiered. We see Mary Magdalene at the base, like Rennes-le-Chateau, the whole thing's a layer cake. So you've got her at the gateway or entranceway, if you will, to this temple. On top of the painting of Magdalene at the base is our step pyramid, again, our stairway to heaven motif. On top of that is another tower, the Tour Magdala. And then flanking the altar on either side is a couple, thought to be Joseph and Mary, each holding a twin child. Very mysterious, very controversial about its meaning. Is this actually Jesus and Mary holding their twins? Or is this Joseph and Mary holding the twin of Jesus, whose name is thought to be Thomas, whose name means the twin? We all get crossroads here at Rennes-le-Chateau. We have checkoff points. You can check in, you can check out. It's not the Hotel California. You can move on anytime you like from any aspect of this mystery. And so here you just have to decide, is this Joseph and Mary or Jesus and Mary? And depending on which fork in the road you take, it's going to take you to a different destination. I'm not that concerned about it. I'm not a bloodliner, okay? In other words, I'm not that focused on, you know, who is and who isn't of the bloodline of Jesus and Mary Magdalene. Perhaps I should be more interested in that. God knows I've met enough of the descendants to know, or people who claim to be descendants of Jesus and Mary Magdalene, to believe that, yeah, they're still around. What I want to know is, what's in their blood? And how did their blood get to be divine? What vibration does their blood carry, and how can I alter my own physiology in order to carry more of that light and love that their genealogy is said to be able to transmit? So I'm saying here, the installation of this altar seems to have been the start of a series of redecorations that would lead Saunier to several important discoveries and would make him a wealthy man. This is, of course, the holiest place of the church. It's the holy of holies of Solomon's temple equals the Church of Mary Magdalene. Now, I'm going to get into this more detail tomorrow, but with Asmodeus at the entranceway as the guardian of the Temple of Solomon, and what everything else we see in this altar space, I'm thinking this is a way for Saunier to kind of duplicate the Temple of Solomon. So let's look at Saunier's painting here. He's no Michelangelo, but or Botticelli, or especially Van Eyck, but he does convey a message for us here. He's got the Magdalene with an open book indicating wisdom, the book of love perhaps, a skull, and a living tree in place of the cross. You know, it's Magdalene. She's got her fingers clasped in this way. And he shows us a gateway off in the distance next to a mountain. But Saunier shows Magdalene inside of a cave next to a skull and a book, kneeling in front of a cross that seems to be growing out of the ground like a tree. To some, this indicates that the painting does indeed represent a tomb or a cave, perhaps the tomb of Christ and perhaps Magdalene, and there are enough caves in the vicinity of Rennes-le-Chateau to keep you busy for a lifetime. Trust me, there are lots of mysteries about these caves. Again, everything we see on the surface is just the cover, if you will, for what goes on underground at this place. And I'm not saying I know what goes on underground, but I've got a fairly good clue. Line, power line, clue, lifeline. I'm trying to share it with you, and I'm also trying to grab a hold of your lifeline as well. So perhaps Magdalene is in this cave mourning her companion, her avatar, her rabbi, her husband, who is here symbolized by this kit of tools. What I'm going to show you is that, in fact, these are shorthand symbols for the ascension kit that Magdalene and Jesus' brother James assembled. A kit of tools that represents us, our ultimate spiritual physiology and the way that we climb the ladder, tower, or stairway to heaven. The basis for this is in my book, The Judgment Day Device, where I show Magdalene as the assembler of these ascension tools. As I said before, I kind of view Jesus as her daredevil test pilot. It's like, here, honey, I'm going to put this oil on. You're going to dissolve into your rainbow body, and you're going to go through the portal or gateway, and you're going to come back and you're going to talk to me. You're going to tell us what's going on. I know that sounds like a simplified version of the story, but it's kind of how I look at it. The grail, which is what the treasure of Rennes-le-Chateau is supposed to be, is associated with these symbols. It is also associated with alchemy, and in the alchemical process, the achievement of the grail, or the philosopher's stone, is the creation of the light body. So all of these symbols, as I'm going to show you, relate to the manifestation of the light body. And I think this is part of what Saunier wanted us to see in his altar here. We want to climb this stairway to heaven. We want to go through this tower. We want to journey through it, just like we see Joseph and the baby here, Mary, or Jesus and the baby, Mary and the baby over here. Look at the star veil that's behind her. That's part of the tip-off that Saunier is recreating Solomon's temple, because there was a veil of stars that separated the holy place from the most holy place of that temple. We see the two pillars with the monstrance in between, the host, the heavenly host. And then up above, again, we see the tower. And beyond the tower, what do we see? But the portal, or the gateway. We see Christ and the Magdalene in this gateway, and in particular, what we see is that moment of anointing, where Mary Magdalene is washing Jesus' feet with her hair and preparing to anoint him with her sacred oil, which the Gnostics called chrism, the sacred oil which they said was the source of the resurrection. We're talking about an oil that dissolves the body into the rainbow body. Like the Essenes, Mary Magdalene undoubtedly read the Book of Enoch. Without question, she read and studied the Book of Enoch. And in the Book of Enoch, we're told the story of the Archangel Michael manifesting before Enoch, extracting Enoch from his earthly clothes and anointing him with an oil. This oil, this anointing with this shining oil, the Book of Enoch tells us, causes Enoch's transformation from a mortal human into an immortal human who wears the luminous garment of light, the luminous garment of an angelic being, one of the glorious ones. In fact, he says, there was no difference between me and the other glorious ones once his body was dissolved into light by this oil. Now, no one else will say this to you, but I will say it to you, and I'm going out on a line to say so, and just say, Mary Magdalene's oil and this oil that Enoch used, or was used on Enoch, the same thing. The exact same thing. They did the same thing. In fact, the Book of Enoch says that the oil's appearance was greater than the greatest light, and its ointment is like sweet dew, and the fragrance like myrrh, and it's like the rays of the glittering sun. We're talking not about an actual oil contained in that jar, but rather that jar being a symbol for our consciousness. Our body is that jar, that holy vessel that contains this oil already. And what we need to learn to do is to get our esoteric or occult physiology, our neurocircuitry, to work, to produce this oil, to manufacture it from within us. Okay, so it's just an oil out here. And, you know, this is your checkoff point again, guys. You're either going to say, yep, no, I'm really convinced that Mary Magdalene did possess an actual oil, and William Henry's kind of off the ball here. Or you're going to say, you know what, this is kind of making sense here, that it'd be far more profound for them to teach us to fish rather than for them to have to always provide us fish. I mean, why do we have to wait for Mary Magdalene to show up to know the recipe for this oil? Wouldn't it be smarter of them on this mission to save as many souls as possible to say, wait a minute, no, it's really all about what's going on inside of you. You're the vessel. You're the alabaster jar. You're that jar. You're the holy grail. And what our teaching about is helping you to transform your body into that vessel to hold that oil. That takes us to the next level of our mystery, Blue Apples Parchment and the Secret of Sion. So let's dive in. Sonia found a couple of parchments here. Two of these parchments, or several parchments rather, two of them are said to be comprised of genealogies, one dating from 1244 and the other from 1644. The other two were composed in the 1780s by Abbe Bijou, one of Sonia's predecessors at the Church of Mary Magdalene. With his discovery and secrets of these scrolls contained, voila, Sonia soon went from rags to riches to big-time nouveau riche, and from lowly churchmen to the highest echelon of occult Parisian society. The two genealogies, of course, are claimed to have been the Merovingian dynasty. They're reported to have been the descendants, pagan kings of the cult of Diana. Merove, who gave his name to the dynasty, is said to have been the result of the blending of the genetic material of a half-man, half-fish god being and his human mother. The authors of Holy Blood, Holy Grail say there's something fishy going on here and suggest that this legend is an allegorical representation of the intermarriage between Merovae's bloodline and the descendants of Jesus and Mary Magdalene, who became the bloodline of Jesus, the Meru or Merovingians. These parchments have never seen the light of day. Copies abound, however, the originals are missing. So here's another question mark checkoff point for us. But let's just take the clue. Let's take the power cord, let's take the vine, let's take the line here and go with it. Let's look at the Sion parchment. The first parchment, which I call the Sion parchment, tells of Jesus and his disciples exploring the cornfield on the Sabbath. The story has been pulled together from three separate sources in the book of Matthew, Mark, and Luke. At the time Jesus went out on the Sabbath day through the corn, and his disciples were hungered and began to pluck the ears of corn and to eat. But when the Pharisees saw it, they said unto him, Behold, the disciples do that which is not lawful to do upon the Sabbath day. But he said to them, Have ye not read what David did when he was hungered and they went there with him? How he entered the house of God, equals the temple of Solomon, and did eat the shewbread. The shewbread is this cosmic star food, the manna. It's supposed to feed the light body and activate our latent spiritual capabilities. It wasn't lawful for him to eat it, neither for them which were with him, but only for the priests. And then we go on to hear from Jesus, Have you not read in the law how on that Sabbath days the priests in the temples profane Sabbath and are blameless? But I say to you that this place is one greater than the temple. He's referring to the cornfield. Now, people want to say that Rennes-le-Chateau is that place, that holy place. That's a possibility. But I'm also asking you to think that that holy place is within you first. And by journeying to this holy place, we'll be able to tap into our own inner holy place. For some, this parchment revealed a treasure map. It's of immense interest to those seeking gold and other treasure in the area of Rennes. To the alchemist, corn and gold are interchangeable. So they're looking for the love of power here. Show me the gold. Show me the money, right? The strange arrangement of its letters concealed, we are told, the sacred geometry whose decoding ultimately revealed the existence of a 20-square-mile pentagramal temple as a landscape feature on Rennes. It was revealed to Henry Lincoln, and to mathematician David Wood, for one example. It also revealed the alleged location of the tomb of Jesus to Richard Andrews and Paul Schellenberger, who were authors of the book Tomb of God, for another. So you can see this is like a Rorschach test, in a way. You can look into this and pull any rabbit out of this hat that you want. And you just have to decide what you can live with. And in my case, you know, I've lived with this for 20 years or so and changed some of my opinions about what I think is there and what's going on. As I've expressed, other authors have done the same too. So you have to just take this at face value and say, all right, I'm going to, you know, proceed with this because I've got a deep interest in this, and I'm going to follow my path, okay? This parchment also contains a cipher, which contains the message, to Dagobert, too, king, and to Sion belongs this treasure, and he is there dead. This cipher has been used by many seekers to pry open the Rennes mystery, in particular, the connection with the Priory of Sion, another rabbit hole that we're just going to not go down. This treasure belongs to Dagobert II, king, and to Sion, and he is there dead. So, Sion, tell me about Sion. What are you talking about? Well, you go to the Bible, book of Hebrews, says you have come to Sion, to the heavenly Jerusalem, the city of the living God. You have come to thousands upon thousands of angels in joyful assembly. So Sion, to whom this treasure belongs, is either an earthly locale, Jerusalem, which is also called Sion, or the celestial Sion. And as you can imagine, I prefer to try to connect with the celestial Sion. I'm looking at the Rennes-le-Chateau mystery and all of it as offering some clues for how we connect with the celestial location where the resurrected Christ dwells, along with angels gathered in joyful assembly and some other people who are called just humans made perfect, just humans made whole, holy, and complete. In Christian art, when they portray the throne of Christ in Sion, you always can identify it because it's got the pulsing rainbow rings. That's Sion. Another example here, we see various figures following the pathway through this gateway up to the celestial Sion, where Christ is enthroned on his arcing rainbow, on his throne with the mystic lamb by it. Lots to talk about the mystic lamb on Sunday again. And this open portal or gateway behind him. So Sion is the celestial location. It's thought to lie at the center of the world and on top of Yahweh's holy mountain, also called Sion, whose base was rooted in the depths of the underworld and whose height reaches into the heights of Zaphon and stretches into the farthest heavens. So you get to use your imagination and decide the farthest heavens for me, the location of Christ's throne, is way out there, as far as you can imagine. Personally, I like to localize it. I put it at the center of our Milky Way galaxy. I've explained why in other presentations. Don't have enough time to go into it today. I'm just asking you to say, okay, let's think of the celestial location as the center of the galaxy. But let's also recognize that in Kabbalah, the more esoteric reference is made to Sion being the spiritual point from which reality emerges. It's also the name, as I said, for the Holy of Holies, Solomon's Temple. This, I believe, is the secret the Templars discovered beneath the Temple of Solomon. This is the secret that Sonia discovered at Rennes-le-Chateau, that Sion is that still point within us that can open a portal or gateway into the celestial region. We should know also that Sion, according to Ezekiel, is Eden, and that's the promised land. So when Joshua and Caleb went looking for the grapes of the promised land, as we saw in Poussin's painting, they're looking for Sion. They're looking for the gateway or the portal to Sion. Because remember, we were evicted from Eden equals the promised land equals Sion long ago. We were denied our divinity at that time. We were evicted from this place of pure light and pure love. We were given coats of skin at this time upon our eviction from this place of pure light and love. Those are our earthly bodies. We were denied entry into Sion by a flashing flaming sword that is guarded or protected by angelic beings. And ever since this time, our aim has been to recover the fruit that Eve shared with Adam that caused us to be evicted from Eden equals Sion. We're seeking that fruit, and that fruit is often referred to as an apple, which takes us now to the second parchment, the blue apples parchment, which begins with the words Jesus, and it tells the New Testament story of Jesus having dinner with wine, I presume, in Bethany with Lazarus and Mary Magdalene. The code of parchment 2 is made using a passage from the Gospel of John. Shortly after Christ raises Lazarus from the dead, he's having dinner with Mary, Lazarus, and a disciple. Mary takes a pound of ointment of spikenard, very costly, and anoints Christ's feet with it. That's, I think, added later. I think that's a diversion, but you have to make up your own mind about it. She begins wiping his feet with her hair. Judas Iscariot, disgusted at the waste of something so valuable, remarks, why was this ointment not sold for 300 pence and given to the poor? Then the passage continues, then he said, not that he cared for the poor, but because he was a thief and had the bag and bear what was put therein. Then said Jesus, let her alone. Against the day of my burial has she kept this, for the poor always you have with you, but me not always. The scene of the passage is illustrated in the stained glass in the portal behind the tower of Sonier's altar. And it may be just a simple ritual anointing of a pagan king by his bride and queen. That's perfectly reasonable. But Jesus specifically says that against the day of my burial has she kept this, indicating that it was meant to anoint his dead body before it was placed in the tomb. The question emerges, was this tomb in Rennes-le-Chateau, and was in fact this oil a critical part of his manifestation of the rainbow body or the light body, as I propose? There's extra letters and numbers in this parchment. A Frenchman named Gerard de Sede claims to have had the means to decipher this text provided to him by this mysterious group, the Priory of Sion. And the story of his decipherment of this coded manuscript is fascinating. It's complicated. It's best told by other authors. But the fact is, it just leaves us with a message. A literal message, once translated into English, that approximates the following. Shepherdess, no temptation to which Poussin and 10 years keep the key piece 681 with the cross and the source of God. I complete or destroy this demon guardian at midday. Blue apples. There it is. The blue apples. Poussin leads us on, or rather, Sonier leads us on this amazing Holy Spirit dove goose chase, if you will, trying to decipher the meaning of all this, the key piece 681. What is it? Shepherdess, no temptation. Well, you know, all of these words are important. But ultimately, it leads into the core of the apple for me. The core of the apple is the pentacle, the pentagram. When we slice the apple, as we see here, we reveal the pentacle or the pentagram. And we are told that some consciousness intentionally somehow manifested these various locations, including Bougarache, Bézu, and Rennes-le-Chateau, using the landscape to create this sacred portal. You know, I don't know. I hope so. Makes sense in a lot of ways. But again, there's a lot more going on in this region that we don't have to rely on these fairly obtuse and mysterious kind of renderings. We can go there and put our boots on the ground and tell for ourselves there's something extraordinary going on here. The term blue apples has been explained by previous authors as an idiom used locally in southern France to refer to grapes, and therefore its use in the parchment is a reference to the symbol of the vine, representing the bloodline of Christ. But there's perhaps another level of meaning here as well. As I said, I think of the cluster of grapes as symbolic of the energy that feeds the light body and our connection to the stars and other star systems. And that, again, is what Joshua and Caleb stole, as portrayed here in Poussin's painting. What did Jesus do with this fruit of the promised land? Well, we know what he did with it. According to the Codex Brucianus, one of the Gnostic Gospels, he made a light body out of it. In my view, that is an absolute validation, if not proof, of my theory or hypothesis about what we're actually talking about here. They know how to manifest these spiritual substances that feed our light body and enable us to open these portals or gateways. The Codex Brucianus is a Gnostic text discovered in Egypt by James Bruce, 1769. It's called the Gnosis of the Light. It contains the first and second books of Jo in three fragments, one on the passage of the soul through the archons of the mist. It's a path of souls journey. And in my work, The Path of Souls, I get into what the Cathars knew about this, and I'll talk a little bit about it on Sunday as well. This Gnostic gospel features the Gnostic cross that we see here. And it says, for Jesus, the fruit of the aeons became the body of light. And I believe the fruit of the aeons is the grapes of the promised land, the blue apples. He crossed the aeons of the indivisible body until he came to the alone begotten. He was in the monad and he dwelt in peace and solitude. He received the grace of the alone begotten, that is to say, his perfect Christhood or his perfecting. So the Codex Brucianus is saying that from this substance, this fruit, Christ received his perfect body, his light body, his resurrection body, his glory body. That's the cluster of grapes. That's why we're so locked on to this place. This is what we're looking for. It goes on to say, he is the father of all light sparks, the chief of the immortal bodies, clearly connecting the grapes of the promised land with the body of light. And the Codex Brucianus tells us that this body of light is the vehicle in which the adept can cross the midst, the regions of consciousness where mechanical cause and effect prevail in contact with Pleroma, which is the Gnostic term for the center of the Milky Way galaxy, according to researchers like John Lamb. So what we're talking about here is a cosmic essence or substance that might be in the soil at this place that could be sucked up by the grapes of the promised land. And when you drink the wine there, it could be activating something within our DNA. That's my hypothesis. That's why I love to go there. That's the promise I make. If you walk this place with me, you will be saturating your vehicle in this energy. And you will have experiences, as many people do on our tours. They feel this, they experience it, they see things, and they are transformed in a positive way by dipping in to these waters and eating this fruit. The Codex Brucianus tells us that beyond the light body is the grace body, beyond the stars, the robe of glory into which the star-like body was transformed, the horos, the limit or boundary of the worlds, or the mist. This cherish or charity or resurrection were the names given to this boundary. It's the boundary that separates flesh from light. It's the boundary the watchers willfully crossed. It's the light that they wanted to share with us. And the veil or curtain was made of this substance. In French, blue apples is les palmes bleues. And the French word palm comes from apom, meaning the sun ball. The English word apple, says Webster's Dictionary, also means eye stone or anything round. And rolling these definitions together, as I did in my book, Blue Apples, reveals that the blue apples can refer to the blue eye of the sun. Now, we've got about 15 to 30 minutes left, as I understand it. Robin had said we can go over. So I'm just going to use this time to kind of walk you through what I see going on internally with the blue apples. Should just take maybe 10 more minutes or so, and then if Robin has time available, we can do this. I'd like to go for some questions then, if we can. Okay. So before we do that, again, thank you so much for coming this far. I hope you're enjoying our journey and that you're feeling real connection with these mysteries. So when I look here at Jesus, the resurrected Jesus, on this blue orb, I'm thinking this could be the blue apple, the blue light of the sun, the palm blue, the apom that he's riding upon. The blue apple, in my view, is interchangeable with the blue pearl of the Gnostic Gospels, of the hymn of the pearl, of the blue dot, the blue angel, the blue stone. It's an exquisite, enchanting blue light. Although it's just a dot, this tiny light contains the whole universe. It's the seed of the heart. It is the supreme within us. In fact, the goal of meditation and the siddha practice is to see this blue pearl or blue apple and ultimately to go inside it and merge with it. Within the blue pearl, you will see the deity you have personal devotion to, be it Pitta, Jesus, Buddha, Sai Baba, Krishna, Brahma. They all are featured holding this blue orb, blue apple, blue pearl, blue stone. Chintamani, or Chintamani, is another name for this wish-fulfilling jewel. It is the symbol of the seed of the divine within us, the great seed of the divine within us. And all the souls are part of the cluster of grapes that represent the fruit of this promised land. So here we see the medicine Buddha in his portal or gateway, rainbow ring around his consciousness, holding that blue medicine ball. Blue pearl is considered to be the seed of consciousness, and it's found in the crown chakra and located in the pineal gland. It is the jewel of Mani, or the golden lotus. And we're looking here at the calcite microcrystals in the human pineal gland that resembles clusters of grapes or blue apples. This is the meaning, by the way, of the stone and the grail held by Melchizedek at Chartres Cathedral, because the activated pineal gland, the pineal gland is called the philosopher's stone as well. It's crystal. Therefore, it's the philosopher's crystal, or crystalline stone. In this painting by M.K. Cerulean, it was commissioned by Manly B. Hall, we see the opening of the third eye. This is Athena or Minerva, the virgin, which shows in part the activities of the pineal gland and the pituitary body at the time of the opening of the third eye. The kundalini fire, which is equivalent with the Holy Spirit, that rose through the feet of Christ. This is why Mary Magdalene anointed the feet. This energy rises through our body and comes up our ladder or stairway to heaven, rising like the phoenix or the dove, as shown here, through our spinal canal in the shape of the dove. And then it kickstarts the pineal gland. It activates this manufacturing plant of secretions. It contains those oils, the chrism, the source of the resurrection. And so here we see the kundalini fire, the Holy Spirit is rising upward through the spinal canal to the pons of the medulla oblongata. And the golden light radiating from the base of the brain at the back gradually increases in size and intensity until it forms the nimbus or halo of the saint. This is Mary Magdalene. This is Nefertiti. This is all of the illuminated divine beings who have activated the latent capability within them and have lifted the serpent. This is what this means. They have lifted the serpent of healing, that like Moses did in the wilderness and like John the Baptist is doing in the Church of Mary Magdalene. Muktananda describes how at one point he experienced this blue pearl expand until it became the size of a human being. So Muktananda is in meditation. He sees this brilliant blue apple in front of him and it expands to the size of a human being. And inside he saw a magnificent being made of shimmering blue light. This blue being gave him some advice and a blessing and then reduced in size to the blue pearl and entered Muktananda. Now, what we're looking at here is a painting by Hildegard of Bingen after one of her visionary experiences. I can't help but thinking that she fired her kundalini, activated the pineal gland, and had this divine blue light radiating from within her, and it projected from within her, and she saw Christ manifest before her. And perhaps like Muktananda, she recognized that she could enter this cosmic egg as a portal or a womb that could take her to another realm. Sion. That's the purpose of the blue apples and this meditation. And I believe that maybe Sanye himself might have experienced this. Traditional shamanic peoples around the world say the blue stone, the blue apple, is actually how our soul travels to the inner realm. And it is inside a quantum egg or an interphasic state of existence where we're able to jump back and through forth from flesh to light, through time, or to cross great distances, or even to use this skill on the planet. Here we see in Giovanni da Paolo's painting from the Divine Comedy of Christ in the Ouroboros, the golden serpent, manifesting the radiating blue light. He's in the blue pearl, the blue apple. He's traveling here in the blue pearl in this ascension image by Rabula. In the Transfiguration images, we will often see this blue gateway open behind Christ. He puts on the bright white garment of light in the baptism. Then he opens it at the Transfiguration, where we see the opening of the gateway, this radiant portal of light opens. This, to me, and this is just my opinion, is the secret of the blue apples. And what we come to the mountain of Rennes-le-Chateau to learn how to do is to activate our mystic anatomy, to get our pineal gland to secrete these oils, to anoint ourselves, to light our candle, which is our pineal gland, so that we can light other people's candles. And I'm not saying I know how to do that. I'm saying I believe that that's what we need to do, but I'm gathering together with folks like you because maybe you do know how to do it. And you will be able to light my candle. And then I can turn and light someone else's candle. So our fundamental problem is that none of our elevators, none of our towers, none of the elevators in our tower go to the top like Magdalene and Christ did. But what we can do is get our elevator to go one floor higher. And this is what is happening today. We're being shown images of wormholes that lead from point A in the universe to point B, as if there's nothing in between, and we recognize, okay, I get it. Those blue apples, well, Christ is ascending in a portal, that's a wormhole. He's traveling through some kind of cosmic conduit, and he's gone through a portal, maybe even at Rennes-le-Chateau, to these other locations. That's what these parchments and these clues about the Rennes-le-Chateau mystery, or Blanchefort tombstone, Eden Arcadio Ego. This is seal. This is arc or arca, the Arcadia, the Greek notion of paradise in the golden age. It's the place of bliss. And when we're in the state of bliss, when we've got the blue apples, the kundalini firing, and the pineal activated, we're in that blissful state. We're in the arc that will take us across the cosmos. We are in the center of the stone. We're in the place where we can render and return home, which are all the meanings of the words rend and render and so forth. We're in the cave of the Royal Ark. We have re-entered the golden age, as all this symbolism suggests. We are entering the portal of Sion. And this is, again, what Poussin wished for us to see, as he has the Magdalene and the shepherds, the watchers, who are shown here flanking the tomb and pointing to the word Arca as they stand and look back to the Magdalene and say, we got it. We got the message. We're with you. We're on the same page. And the key that Poussin embedded in this painting is that this tomb, this location might be in Rennes-le-Chateau. And the question now that we'll save for our next presentation is, What's in that tomb? What did they deposit at Rennes-le-Chateau? What are those additional secrets that we're supposed to get there? I get this aspect about my body and the blue apples and all that, but we know that there's more there because we're told that there's more there. And by following the Rhesus pieces, I've come to a hypothesis of what I think is there. And I will share that with you in tomorrow's presentation, which is about the Ark of the Covenant, the Templars and their connection to this area, and what I feel is the actual secrets of this Ark. So now, what I'm going to do is come back up out of our presentation, and I'm going to go up here to put the chat on, and I'm going to ask if Mike or Robin or anybody needs to tell me, give me any further directions here about questions and Q&A or anything we can discuss.
Well, I think I just would like to remind everyone out there that if you scroll up and mouse over the little scroll bar at the top, the green scroll bar, and click on chat, it will open up the chat box for you. And then we'd love to get your questions and comments. William, this was incredible.
Well, thank you, Robin, very much. I'm thrilled to hear that. I had a blast myself. Could use another 6 hours to look at some of this, but I think we put something on the table here that we can build from tomorrow and Sunday.
Yes, I mean, the detail and, you know, your perspective on this this storyline is just really just opens up a new world of who we are.
You
know, so thank you.
Thank you very much. Appreciate that. So I don't know how we proceed from here, Robin. If I click on any questions, or if people just can some.
Eloise has asked a question, so I am going to open up her mic. So, Eloise, if you would like to ask that directly now.
Hi, William. I was wondering, if we were kicked out of the Garden of Eden so we wouldn't have this knowledge, why is it okay that we have this knowledge now?
Well, it's actually maybe not okay that we have it at any time throughout history, because as we're going to explore on Sunday, the Cathars were reputed to have possessed this knowledge, and they were exterminated by the church. In fact, you can look throughout time and you can notice that anybody that is attempting to get this knowledge, not anybody, but quite a few groups have been persecuted because of their pursuit of this knowledge. And I'm not saying that to try to put an issue, a paranoid spin on this or anything, but I'm just simply saying this is the knowledge that is considered heresy throughout the ages. And anytime humankind, whether it being the recreating the tower of, or building the Tower of Babel in an attempt to open that gate, or the story of Jesus and Mary Magdalene, people suffer as a result of that. And I don't think that that should prevent us from pursuing this with all our heart and all our soul, because as the Tibetans teach, the only way we're going to get off this rock is by attaining our rainbow body. And of course, their good news is we can achieve it in one lifetime, and every lifetime we've been working on it, our knowledge accumulates and is cumulative. But the fact is, even the Tibetans themselves have recently been persecuted by the Chinese because of this specific knowledge about the rainbow body. The elite, whoever you think they are, don't want a planet full of people popping into their rainbow body, because that completely changes the Earth game, and that's seemingly unacceptable.
Great. That's great. We have another question from Ignatius. So I'm going to unmute his mic.
Okay.
There we go.
Can you hear me?
Yes,
Ignatius.
Okay, great. William, I was curious, because you were talking about the oil from the pineal gland. Are you familiar with the description of the white powder in the sarcophagus of the King's Chamber of the Great Pyramid?
Yes, I am.
Which is supposed to be from the pineal gland?
Right.
Would that be the same thing?
You know, I don't know. I can't. I'm still looking into that. I'm trying to reconcile that. I do view the Great Pyramid, especially the King's Chamber, as a resurrection machine, a transfiguration machine. And so I can see how that would be possible. But, you know, I still have questions about all of that. And so I can't say that I can go along with that wholeheartedly. I wish I could. But I'm going to be continuing that because we're going to talk about it a little bit more tomorrow, because in fact, that white powder manna substance, that cosmic star food as it's also called, is part of the ascension kit. So it's vital that we come to some firm conclusions or understandings of what exactly that is and how it's produced. Okay. So I'll save some of that for tomorrow.
Okay, great. Thanks.
Mm-hmm. You're welcome. Thank you. And by the way, I should just interject here that that's Magdalene's knowledge. It was no mistake that when Jesus shows up as a rock star Messiah wannabe at Capernaum, and the elders say, okay, you're acting a little too uppity here. You think you're Moses, so we'll have a little bit of that manna star food now. And that's exactly when Mary Magdalene came into Jesus' life, mission, ministry, however you want to term it. And so when I look at that, I think, oh, yeah, she's the one who's got that knowledge, because if she doesn't show up, they've already strung him up and stoned him. And so, but she helps him. She knows that alchemical knowledge, and she helps him manifest that, and off we go. And that substance we're talking about is the bread, the host, that was present at the Last Supper when Jesus shared the power, the exousia, with the disciples.
Wow.
So.
Yeah. Well, there are so many comments in the chat. People seem to be a little shy about asking questions. I would love to call on Franklin because he's been putting in so many wonderful questions, and he was going to have to dash out for a call, but I see he's still on. So, Franklin, I'm going to unmute your mic.
Okay. Can you hear me?
Yes,
Franklin.
Great. Well, you know, I just want to tell you what a magnificent and fabulous presentation this is. This is like real information of the eternal mysteries, the body of light and immortality, and you did an amazing job here.
Thank you. Thank you, Franklin, very much.
So a question would be the image from the altarpiece, the resurrected Christ as a being of yellow light. Do you see that image as the image of a mushroom?
Yeah, I could absolutely go along with that. I'm fairly familiar with the Christ as a mushroom theory. I see some of that, and I think it's an important aspect of the mystery. I don't think it's the whole thing.
No.
But I do believe that it's important. I absolutely concur with the connection. I used to lecture with James Arthur, who was the one who first brought that to my attention. And from time to time, I still get emails from people, readers of James Arthur's work and others that follow the Christ as a mushroom hypothesis. And I'm just fascinated by it. I think it's there's a lot to it.
And the painting by Poussin, I think this was your information, but it absolutely blew my mind when I read an article that looked at Poussin's painting of Shepherds of Arcadia and analyzed it as this view of the sky with galactic center in the middle. That's in the tomb.
Gosh, I haven't seen that. I'd be really utterly blown away to see something like that. So
it's
maybe
a great revelation. Yeah, great revelation.
Absolutely, absolutely. And that would fit right in with my hypothesis that Sion is the center of the Milky Way galaxy, which is, by the way, it's a little out there to some people, but this is the belief of, in fact, the Church of Latter-day Saints. They believe that God's home planet is called Kolob, and it's located at the center of the galaxy, and it's home to the perfected ones of a whole race of beings called the City of Enoch were raised or translated to Kolob, and one day will return. So, I mean, it sounds kind of wacky, but not anymore. I mean, we live in the age of beaming. We live in the age of quantum consciousness, Christ consciousness, all this. This is the normal world that we're coming back into awareness of here. We've been in the dark world. Now we're coming into the light. It's like, hey, good morning, guys. So.
Great. Thank you.
That was great.
We have a question from Linda, and she would like me to ask it. And that is, have you ever encountered what you feel are obvious barriers from otherworldly sources that are standing in the way of your studies? She's been dealing with this for a couple of years and wants to know if you call upon archangels for protection from these sources throwing up barriers from many directions.
Otherworldly, no. I mean, like everybody, you have some things that make you go, huh? And I should actually be protecting myself more, perhaps. I tend to go kind of wide open and sort of trusting, I guess, in a way. I presume to be more terrestrial interference, but nothing otherworldly.
Yeah, people that don't want the information out here.
Yeah, and I'll be forthcoming with that. I don't mean to sound like, you know, ooh, what's he talking about kind of a thing. I must have just written and published Blue Apples, because I was on the Art Bell Show. This was around 1998. And I was talking about some of the things we were talking about, including the key piece 681, which everybody wants to know. What's the key piece 681 in that parchment? And I had come to my own conclusions about it. And Art Bell asked me, well, what is it? And I said, well, Art, I would rather not say at this time. And he's like, God damn it. I hate it when people come on my show and act like that. Just tell us what it is. And I'm like, Art, I really would rather not say right now, because I don't want anybody to go out and hurt themselves if I mislead them. Because I'm going to point to an element here that is being used in cancer research that is curing bloodborne diseases, and somebody might get the wild idea to go out and buy some of this stuff and cook it up for themselves, and I wouldn't want to be responsible. And he said, okay, fine. And he let me off the hook. Well, 2 days later, I was going to Atlanta, Georgia to participate in an event with Zachariah Sitchin and some other speakers. And it happened, I got a rental car, and I planned to drive to Atlanta with my then girlfriend. I went out and bought her a gift and picked up the rental car. And there was an ice storm in Nashville that night, which is very unusual. But we were iced in, and I wasn't going to Atlanta that day. But what happened was, is the night before, in the middle of this ice storm, I picked up every scrap of research I have ever done on Rennes-le-Chateau, all my photos, all my books, my laptop computer, everything, and put it in a box and put it in the back of the car, along with her gift. And I went out the next morning to leave, and guess what?
It was gone.
Every bit of it was gone. And I had to go back and recreate all of my research. Somebody later told me it was maybe one of the intelligence agencies or something. I don't know. So I'm just trying to be forthcoming in answering your question and tell you that there's an aspect of this where people really, really want to know what's going on with this mystery right here. And so after that, I just kind of took it as a message to sort of back off on my key piece 681 research and really haven't gone back to it. But what I will say is that I believe that there's an element in the soil there, that the Templars used to grow cannabis, and they grew grapes in the vicinity of Rennes-le-Chateau. And I believe that the cannabis and the grapes functioned as a filter to lift this element out of the soil. And then the Templars would turn that cannabis into an oil and stick it in their ear where the blood vessels are closest to the skin. The Essenes did the same thing. They never smoked cannabis, but they made an oil out of it and put it in their ear. And I believe that that's what was going on with the key piece 681, is that there's something in the soil there in that vicinity that can activate our light bodies, and that's what it's actually talking about.
Wow. Wow, how interesting.
Yeah, very.
Very.
So,
cool.
For what it's worth.
Yeah, thank you. Okay,
yeah.
Well, we're just getting more like wows and psychocosmic acceleration and wonderful
comments. I say all this because this information, it's not mine. It doesn't belong to me. In fact, it's probably pretty useless to me, but it's in sharing it with you and us being able to work on it together that it has some value and we're able to make something out of it. So
yeah.
That's my motivation here.
Yeah, great. Okay, well, I look forward to tomorrow.
Absolutely, yeah. So tomorrow it's the Ark of the Covenant and the Templar connection to this area, and Magdalene's Ascension Kit. I know there's a lot of people that know a lot about Mary Magdalene and are expert in it, but I was kind of surprised to see that they kind of overlooked the pieces that I'll be bringing to you tomorrow. And I'm going to look very much forward to presenting those pieces and assembling them.
Wonderful presentation, and we'll see you and everyone tomorrow.
Wonderful. Well, thank you, everybody. Have a wonderful rest of your day, and we'll see you same time, same place tomorrow.